I don't know that this is as true today as it was a few years ago because of the economic situation, not only in this country, but worldwide, and the impact it's having on churches. But I can tell you that a few years ago, if you were in any kind of leadership position in the church, you were constantly flooded with brochures for seminars and teachings and get-togethers on church growth seminars and on leadership seminars, right? And we're going to do the first thing I want to talk about is church growth. Now, that sounds like a good thing, right?
Sounds
like a good thing. But kingdom growth is what we're supposed to be involved in, which is not necessarily what people perceive as church growth. Because that's the first thing you see in Acts chapter 6. Now, at the time when the disciples were increasing in number. So there was growth going on in the church. Okay, is that a good thing? Okay, I'll take you off the hook. Absolutely, positively. You want, I mean, you know, that's the purpose. God the Father, Peter says, his desire is that none should perish. You know, he wants everybody to come in. Now, everybody's not going to come in. That's a fact. Jesus said, you know, that the way is hard, it's narrow, that leads to this relationship with the Father and eternal glory. And the way to destruction is wide and easy. Many of those will go the wrong way and few of those who will go the right way. Right? So while his desire, his heart's desire is that everybody be saved, and that is his heart's desire,
yes.
The fact of the matter is that's not going to be the case. Right?
That's right.
So when we talk about the number of disciples increasing, that should be a burden on our hearts if we're talking about people being saved, the lost being saved and coming into a righteous relationship with the Father through the work, the atoning work of Jesus Christ on the cross.
Now that's the growth that's good.
That's what we want. But now, when it comes to church growth, there is, as the movie said, the good, the bad, and the ugly.
That's right.
All right? The good is, and let's just look at why do churches grow? Well, the good reason that churches grow is because, well, Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me.
Mm-hmm.
And where the Word of God is preached in truth and in power, the whole counsel of God, people are going to be drawn to Him. The Word of the cross. Paul says the Word of the cross in 1 Corinthians in the first chapter, he says, the Word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to those who are being saved, it is the power of God unto salvation.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
So
if the word is being preached, the word of the cross is being preached, if Christ is being lifted up and being exalted, men are going to be drawn to him. That's the truth. And that's what draws people into the kingdom of God. That's the good. We want to see that happen. And certainly that was happening prior to Acts chapter 6 here.
Mm-hmm.
On the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, Peter goes out into the street. What does he preach? He preaches Christ and him crucified. And 3,000 were added that day to the kingdom of God. So that's a good, and we want to have that. That's the growth that we want to see in the body of Christ. But then there's also the bad. Now what's the bad? I'm going to read you a couple of verses. And by the way, I suggested before, you really might want to have some paper and pencil or pen and just take some notes. And it's always a good idea to make notes so you can check on what I'm saying. Don't just take my word. I tell people, don't take my word for anything. Because you're supposed to examine all things and hold fast that which is good.
Right.
You know, it says, John wrote and said, we're supposed to test the prophets from many false, test the spirits, many false prophets who go on abroad. So you need to be testing the things. You need to hear what I'm telling you from the Lord. Otherwise, it doesn't generate faith in your life. All right. The devil wants his minions to infiltrate the church to destroy. He wants church growth. He wants his people going into the church for the purpose of destroying, right? Galatians chapter 2, verse 4 says this, but it was because of the false brethren secretly brought in who had sneaked in to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, in order to bring us into bondage. So here's an example where Paul is talking about where people are coming into the church and their purpose was to spy out the liberty and bring us into bondage. And then, listen to this, Acts chapter 20, verse 29 and 30. I know that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves Men will arise, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after them. Paul wrote to the Corinthians and talked about how he had this concern that there would be, because they were accepting a false gospel, they were listening to things they shouldn't be listening to. He said, I'm concerned lest the serpent who deceived Eve come along and remove the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. And then he goes on to talk about false apostles coming into the church, right? And he says, that shouldn't surprise you. Because if Satan comes as an angel of light, how much more will his servants, his ministers, come into the church? There is so much instruction in the New Testament about the danger, and this is one of the schemes of the devil, that he will send people into the church for the purpose of destroying the church. That's the Baal. And there is a third reason. The ugly. There's the good, the bad, and the ugly. What's the ugly? Well, this is probably the most prevalent thing in the Western world today about church growth. And so many people have been built churches on this, that people will be drawn into the church to feed their flesh rather than to feed their spirit. Jesus answered this, the crowds who followed him and called him rabbi. And he said, truly, truly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. They were getting food. That's why they were coming.
They were feeding the flesh.
They were feeding the flesh. Mm-hmm. This is exactly what Jesus said. And let me tell you, that comes from John chapter 6. And you need to read that, because there is a picture of apostasy that happens when his words become too difficult. And where his words are too difficult, that whole counsel of God, people leave. So what happens is, for church growth, you don't preach the whole counsel of God, you don't preach the hard things, so people stay. And you grow, and you grow, and you grow. Now, I'm going to tell you something. It's the heart of God. Not only that people be saved, that the Lord ministers to their spiritual needs, and the greatest spiritual need you have is salvation. But then he wants to minister to the physical needs. His desire.
Of course.
His desire is to bring blessing to his people. But that can't be separated from the spiritual. What all of this is about, what Christianity is about, is your relationship with God Almighty, God the Father. And the only way you get that is through that most ugly event that the world has ever seen.
Yes.
That's the ugliest event that ever happened, was Jesus Christ on a cross. Mm-hmm. That is also the most wondrous event that has happened in the history of mankind since the fall of Adam and Eve in the garden. Because if it were not for the horror of the cross, nobody would ever know the glory of God. All right?
Mm-hmm.
So we have to not be ashamed of that. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. And like I said, you know, one of the things he talked about was, you know, he determined, Paul, this brilliant, brilliant man, this theologian, this Bible scholar, scripture scholar, said that he had determined to know nothing but Christ and Him crucified. That's what brings people into the kingdom of God. All right?